Yo, what's up, guys? It's Noah here, breaking down the NBA slate on DraftKings and Yahoo for Wednesday, January 1st, first day of the new year, 2020. Hope you guys had a great New Year's Eve. If you went out and did stuff on New Year's Eve, hopefully you stayed safe. Hopefully you had some fun. If you have a day off of work today, hopefully you enjoy that day off work. I'm actually recording this video on New Year's Eve. By the time you're watching this video, it'll probably be Wednesday. It'll be 2020, but I'm recording this New Year's Eve around 9:30 Eastern time. Wanted to get this video up before I leave and go do stuff. So we're going to go through this four-game slate for Wednesday. We have a four-gamer on DraftKings starting at 6 o'clock. And then over on Yahoo, we have a three-game slate. So Yahoo's not including the 6 o'clock game between Orlando and Washington. So there might be some plays I talk about in this game that I can't talk about on Yahoo because that game isn't on their main slate. We'll go through the slate position by position and just touch on the players that stand out to me the most, looking at this slate the night before. As always, guys, before we do get started, I would appreciate it if you would drop a like on the video down below. If you are new to the channel, this is your first time checking out a video on my channel, or if you just haven't subscribed yet, definitely would appreciate it if you would hit that subscribe button. I do have some goals for the new year for 2020 that I want to hit. One of them is definitely going to be to get to 20,000 subscribers. I think we can easily hit that by probably maybe March or maybe even April of 2020. I think we can definitely get there. So if you're someone that watches my videos daily and you're not subscribed, make sure you hit that subscribe button. If you also click the notification bell, that will notify you every time I upload, so that way you won't miss out on any of my new videos. And if you haven't yet, you can check out all the exclusive content I have available on Patreon. I do upload a lot of NBA content to Patreon Monday through Friday. I have my updated core plays. I do a full written article on the slate. I also make a lineup building video that I post in the afternoon. You can get access to all that content over on Patreon. Also, I do put up NFL stuff later on in the week, usually Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sundays when I upload my NFL content. So all the content, or all my exclusive content, is available on Patreon. If you want to get more than just the YouTube videos that I put out daily, I do post these videos as sort of like first looks at the slate. If you want my more in-depth thoughts, you can check out the Patreon, see all that I have to offer over there. It is the beginning of the month, so those are usually the best times to join, so that way you get the most value out of your money. Joining at the beginning of the month is usually what I would recommend if you are going to become a Patreon member. But yeah, guys, let's go ahead and take a look at today's slate. So starting off at point guard, I think this is definitely a slate where we're going to have value. Minnesota is going to be missing like three or four of their key players today, which is just going to open up a lot of value. So it should be pretty easy to pay up if you want to. You do have LeBron as the most expensive point guard, $10,300 on DraftKings. Most expensive point guard on Yahoo as well at $53. LeBron is definitely in play for me on a short four-game slate. I think right now I do prefer to go to Giannis for just a little bit more. Giannis came back from injury in his last game against the Bulls. He was very disappointing. Only played 27 minutes, had 45 DraftKings points. They did win that game in a blowout, so he did lose some minutes to the blowout. But I mean, if you were just like following that game, like he just wasn't that productive at all. I know at the end of halftime, he had like, I think maybe 25 fantasy points, which is pretty bad for Giannis. Like, this is a guy that gives you 55, 60 DraftKings points most nights. I mean, we'll talk more about him when we get a small forward, but I think right now he's the guy that I want to pay up for. He's listed as questionable on DraftKings, but he's actually probable. He's expected to play today. But that will be something we need to monitor, because I think it was a couple slates ago Giannis was probable, and then he wound up not playing. So we'll need to monitor that tomorrow on Wednesday. LeBron, I do like at 10-3. You do have Anthony Davis at 9,900, which feels way too cheap. He's probable to play today. And then you have guys like Lillard, potentially Bradley Beal, Whiteside, Vucevic, Randall, etc. So LeBron's probably my third favorite stud behind Giannis and behind Anthony Davis. I do slightly prefer Davis given that he's a little bit cheaper. Also, I like his matchup quite a bit. But I mean, LeBron you can definitely target here against the Suns. Like, I don't know who the Suns are going to use to defend him. Like, maybe they'll bring like Mikal Bridges off the bench. I really don't know. Maybe Kelly Oubre guards him. I mean, it's going to be a winnable matchup for LeBron, whoever's on him. Like, he can win any matchup. He's one of the most matchup-proof players in the league. I mean, you just look at his assists this season. His assists have been through the roof, averaging nearly 11 assists per game. He's been a great playmaker this season. He's given you a solid floor for fantasy. So obviously LeBron's in play for me. I would prefer him over Lillard. He's 1,100 more than Lillard. Definitely give me LeBron in that situation. But then you have guys like Booker, Rubio, McCollum, Payton in this like 7 to 6K range. Rubio and Booker I both like quite a bit. Both these guys have been playing very well lately, especially Devin Booker. Just the last three games, he's got 44, 54, and 50 DraftKings points. He's playing huge minutes right now as well, 38, 41, 38 minutes. He is $400 more than Ricky Rubio. If you look at like points per minute space this season, just in terms of fantasy points per minute, Rubio has actually been a little bit more productive than Devin Booker this season. And I know Booker's probably going to get more ownership than Rubio. That's what's been happening just the last few slates. These guys have been similarly priced the last few slates, and Booker's been much higher owned. I know Booker's been outscoring him by a slight margin, but I still would prefer to go to Rubio. I prefer him. He's a little bit cheaper on DraftKings, $400 cheaper. On Yahoo, Booker is at shooting guard. He's $34 at shooting guard. Rubio is at point guard, and Rubio's $29. Like, I definitely prefer Rubio, especially when you factor in that he'll probably come in low owned. But I don't think either guy are going to be core plays for me. Shabazz Napier is someone I want to talk about, so he might go overlooked today. I'm not exactly sure. He's $5,800 on DraftKings, which is pretty expensive. But we do already know that Karl-Anthony Towns is going to be out today. Andrew Wiggins is going to be out. Jeff Teague is also doubtful. So all three of those guys are most likely going to be out today. We saw Shabazz Napier play 34 minutes last game against Brooklyn. Had 43 DraftKings points, 24 points, 3 rebounds, 8 assists, and 2 steals. It was just a very productive game from Napier overall. If you look at his rates this season, like, he's been a productive player when he's given the minutes. We can just look at his rates with these guys off the floor. Take Wiggins, Towns off the floor, since we know they're going to be out. Jake Layman's going to remain out. Jeff Teague's also doubtful. Taking off four of those guys off the floor, I don't imagine we get like a crazy sample. Napier's played 81 minutes with those four guys off the floor. 31% usage rate, averaging 0.93 fantasy points per minute, 27% assist percentage. Like, I mean, I think he's going to average probably a fantasy point per minute, if not more. Like, just on the season, he's averaged over a fantasy point per minute. He's going to play huge minutes, especially with Jeff Teague also out. Like, that was pretty much the guy that was taking a couple of minutes away from Napier. Now with Teague out as well, it's possible we get like 36 to 38 minutes from Shabazz Napier in a fast-paced game against the Bucks. The Bucks are first in pace this season. The Timberwolves are fourth. We don't have a total yet on this game, I don't believe. But, I mean, I imagine when we get a total here, it's probably going to be, even with, like, all the Minnesota guys out, like, we're still probably going to see a pretty big total here. The only concern is, like, blowout. This game could definitely blow out. But I think even if it is a blowout, Shabazz Napier probably still plays and is still on the floor in that case. I think he's very safe here. I think the minutes are going to be there. It's a fast-paced game. I know Minnesota or Milwaukee actually hasn't been that great defensively versus point guards this season, if I'm not mistaken. Maybe I'm wrong there, but I really like Napier. He's $12 on Yahoo. He is clearly one of the top value plays over there. If you're going to get away from him, it would be on DraftKings, where they priced him up to $5,800. But honestly, I still think he's a top play on DK as well. I feel like people are probably going to shy away from him at that price, and I think that's definitely a mistake because the minutes are going to be there, and he's been productive this season as the starting point guard, especially just when he's given the minutes. But then other guys you could look to. Jordan McRae is coming off a huge game. He's up to $5,800 on DK. If Bradley Beal plays today, I have no interest in Jordan McRae. If Bradley Beal remains out, you could consider McRae, but I think I still would prefer Napier at the same salary. RJ Barrett, $5,600, you could definitely look to against Portland. I like that matchup quite a bit for him. We know that Barrett's going to play pretty big minutes as long as the game stays close. Not a core play for me, but someone I would sprinkle in into my tournament builds. Same with a guy like Eric Bledsoe. Bledsoe started last game against the Bulls, but he was limited. He only played 16 minutes. He was still incredibly productive, though, scoring 30 DraftKings points in 16 minutes. Like, I imagine Bledsoe probably plays more than 16 minutes today, especially if this is a close game. Obviously, that's a concern because this game definitely has blowout potential. But if it stays close and we get Eric Bledsoe probably playing like 26, 28 minutes, if not more, $5,500 is way too cheap for Eric Bledsoe if he is going to be starting and not limited. So that's a guy I'll for sure be keeping my eye on at point guard. And then for value here, I think we need to go back to the Timberwolves with Jared Culver. $4,800 on DraftKings. Also want to talk about him. So he played 38 minutes last game against Brooklyn. Had 41 DraftKings points. It was his best game of the season. 21 points, 5 rebounds, 3 assists, a block, and 3 steals. I mean, with no Teague, no Wiggins, no Towns, like, I think we probably get 36 to 38 minutes from Culver again. I don't expect him to be nearly as productive as he was last game, but the minutes are going to be there. The usage should be there with, like, Teague, with Wiggins, all those guys off the floor. really cheap on both sites. He's $4,800 on DraftKings. He's $11 on Yahoo. I mean, he looks like one of the top value guards as well, along with Napier. And I just feel like Minnesota in general as a team today is going to be a team we definitely look to, just with how shorthanded they're going to be. These guys are going to have to play huge minutes because they really have no other healthy bodies. Like, we can just look at their roster and just look at how many minutes guys played from last game. So Gorgui Dieng started at center against Brooklyn. He played 33 minutes. Robert Covington started at power forward. He played 35 minutes. Keelan Martin started at small forward ahead of Trevion Graham, who was out that game. He played 35 minutes. We know Culver played 38. Napier played 34. Kata Bates-Diop off the bench played 27 minutes. Naz Reid off the bench played 20 minutes. And I think Okoji off the bench played 18. Yeah, Okoji played 18 minutes, and then Lehman was out. McLaughlin didn't play. Volley was out. Graham was out. Bell got like 4 minutes, and then you had Jeff Teague play 20 minutes before he got injured. Like, you take Teague out there, I mean, it's possible that the Timberwolves run like an 8-man rotation today. Like, they're not going to have a ton of bodies. They're going to have to play these guys big minutes. I think these guys have very high floors just with the minutes they're going to play. Even if this game blows out, like, it's very possible that you get Napier and Culver still out there in a blowout, still playing in a blowout, especially because they're, like, younger guys. At least I know Culver's a younger guy. I think Napier's, like, a young guy, too. So, yeah, I really like these guys as value guards. I think they really stand out on the slate. And then that's probably it for, like, value point guards. So let's go ahead and talk about shooting guard now. His shooting guard, Bradley Beal, if he plays today, $8,700 is way too cheap of a price tag for Bradley Beal. Just with the usage that he's going to get, I mean, we know he's going to play heavy minutes. He leads this team in usage this season. I think he's averaging like 1.35, maybe 1.4 fantasy points per minute. His price has come down because he's been injured. We've seen DraftKings does this when guys get injured and they miss a couple games. Whenever they return and come back to health, I mean, they're like way too cheap. That's the case with Bradley Beal today. So I like him at $8,700. I do like Booker at $7,400 quite a bit. In this mid-range, I think R.J. Barrett you could look to. These Washington guys I'm probably not going to go to today unless unless Beal's out. If Beal is out, then you can play McRae. You can go back to Troy Brown, but now that their prices are up, I don't even consider them like great plays, even if Beal is out. Like, they're not going to be great plays for me. Only guy I would consider probably as like a somewhat top play would be McRae, but even with him at $5,800, there still are other guys I'd rather go to on the slate. Then for value, like, Terrence Ross is a guy that you could consider. I mean, he burned me and a lot of people last slate. Played 28 minutes off the bench with Aaron Gordon out against the Hawks. Had 13 DraftKings points. He gets another great matchup today against the Wizards. I mean, you could definitely go to Terrence Ross at $4,200. I expect the minutes to be there as long as Aaron Gordon remains out. I don't think we have word on Aaron Gordon yet, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, he didn't practice Tuesday, listed as questionable, so we don't know yet with Gordon. I guess we'll need to watch that heading into Wednesday. But if Gordon remains out, you can consider Ross as a value play. Assuming Okoji plays, I think he's going to get a lot of run off the bench. You could definitely look to him at $3,800. I know he's been pretty bad this season in terms of like points per minute. Like, he hasn't been very productive, but the minutes should be there. They have no other healthy bodies. He's only $3,800 on DK. I could see using him as a value play. But moving on to small forward, we got Giannis and LeBron at the top here. Giannis I definitely like on this slate against the Timberwolves. 11-2 on DraftKings, power forward on Yahoo, and $56 over there. I just think we're going to have so much value today that it's going to be really easy to get to Giannis, especially on Yahoo where the price tags weren't really adjusted for the Minnesota guys. Like, all the Minnesota guys are still too cheap. It's going to be really easy to build around Giannis on DK. Like him on Yahoo, and I like him on DraftKings as well. I mean, we know how good this guy is just in terms of like points per minute. I mean, we can look at his rates this season, but you know, or you guys know that his rates are insane. Even with Bledsoe and Middleton healthy now, like, Giannis is still like a 1.8 fantasy point per minute player. Yeah, 988 minutes played this season, averaging 1.87 fantasy points per minute, 37% usage rate, 32% assist percentage, 20% total rebound percentage. Like, I mean, if this guy plays 32 minutes, he can easily go for 60 DraftKings points here. I mean, Robert Covington is probably going to defend Giannis, and Robert Covington's a good defender, but he's not going to shut down Giannis by any means. Giannis went for 61 DraftKings points in only 26 minutes earlier this season against the Timberwolves. He was able to have a ton of success in this matchup, and with like how fast both of these teams play, you got two of the top four teams in pace this season. Like, this is going to be a fast-paced game. A lot of points are going to be scored. Only concern is that if it blows out, which is definitely possible. I mean, I imagine Milwaukee's going to be favored by like 14, 15 here, which makes sense because like Minnesota has nobody to play for them. Like, I imagine they're going to get beat. But we've seen this season, like, teams, they'll be favored big and they'll still lose. Teams will be big underdogs, not expected to win at all, and then they'll wind up winning. Like, it's just really hard to predict if blowouts happen. I'm playing this slate straight up as and I'm going to assume this game stays close. And if that's the case, these guys are going to look really good from the Timberwolves. There's going to be guys I want from the Bucks as well, and Giannis, definitely one of them here in a really fast-paced game. So love Giannis today. Do prefer him over LeBron. Jonathan Isaac, I like a ton in this matchup against the Wizards. Pace up spot here for the Magic. Without Aaron Gordon, we will see Jonathan Isaac start at power forward if Aaron Gordon remains out. He's more productive when he plays at power forward. Played 33 minutes as their starting power forward last game against the Hawks. 37 DraftKings points. Overall was a very productive game from Isaac. I'd imagine he puts up similar numbers today, if not better, in a great matchup against the Wizards. So I really like going to him. I think Kelly Oubre makes some sense at 6,500. He's been balling as of late, playing huge minutes. 53 and 49 DraftKings points the last two games, 40 and 41 minutes. Like, they're giving Oubre a ton of run. 6,500 on DK. I could definitely see using him as well. If people are gonna like game log watch and chase Oubre's big games, I think you can definitely shy away. Because like the game log, although it looks really pretty, I mean, Oubre's still a very like streaky player. If he's not knocking down a ton of shots, I mean, he's not gonna put up those big games. I know he's been rebounding more. Like, he had 16 rebounds in that game against the Kings. Only reason he had such a big game against Portland was because he went for 7 for 10 from 3, 11 for 21 from the field. He was just really hot from the field. If that's the case, I mean, he's going to put up big games, but you can definitely fade those in tournaments, people chasing like the shooting games, I guess. But Carmelo Anthony, he's someone I want to talk about today. I think there's definitely a narrative here for Melo. Getting to face the Knicks today in the Garden, going back to his old stadium. Like, I think there's definitely a narrative. I'm kind of a narrative guy. Like, I think narratives apply more for like NBA than any other sport. Like revenge narratives, like revenge games or whatever, even like coach speak. Like, I think that really has an effect on players, especially in the NBA when you can control how you play. Like in football, a revenge game in football, like you can't really demand the ball. Or in baseball, like facing your old team, like what are you gonna do? Like swing the bat harder, try and hit the ball harder. Whereas in basketball, you can actually like demand the ball, like give me the ball. I'm gonna just take a ton of shots. I'm gonna put on a show. And I think that's what Melo does today. At going back to the Knicks Stadium, back to the Garden to face his old team, I think we're going to see Melo put on a show. I think he's going to chuck a ton. I mean, he's already like taken a ton of shots this season. He's already been a pretty high usage player with Portland. We can just look at his rates this season. Like, I think Melo's a good play today regardless of the narrative, but when you factor in the narrative, that just makes me like him like even more. But just this season with Portland, he's played 597 minutes. 24% usage rate, averaging close to a fantasy point per minute, 0.91 fantasy points per minute. I mean, he's third on the team in usage behind McCollum and Lillard. He's taken a ton of shots, like 15, 14 to 15, 17 shots a game. When he gets hot from the field, like, we know Melo can put up big ceiling games. He's rebounding as well. He's playing huge minutes, 37 minutes in three of his last four games. This game's being played in New York, so I think that makes it likely the game stays competitive right now. 222 total with a 3.5 point spread. I really like Melo here. It's a good matchup. The Knicks aren't good defensively. Melo's back going to the Garden. Like, they're probably going to put like a tribute video up or something. They're definitely going to be like cheering him on. At least I feel like they will. I think Melo's going to try and perform well for the Knicks crowd. I think I'm buying into the narrative today. That's one of the reasons I really like Melo. Maybe that's a fish move, but I think there's definitely a narrative here. On Yahoo, he's at power forward. $22. I think he is one of the better power forward options to go to as well. You do have Giannis and AD you can pay up for. You got Melo and Covington in like the 20 range. Julius Randle at 33, I like a lot here against Portland. I like this matchup for Randle quite a bit. But really, once you get past Covington, there really isn't much I like at power forward. So I expect a lot of my power forward ownership on Yahoo to go to the top four guys, or top five guys, I should say, Giannis through Covington. But love Melo today, chasing the narrative. Maybe it's a fish move, but I think he's going to play well here for his old team, for his old fans, I guess you could say. But Covington, 5,700, you could also consider today. With no Towns, no Wiggins, like, he's going to get more usage. He's been way more productive this season with just Towns off the floor. Take Wiggins and Teague off the floor as well. I mean, that's just more usage to go around. Covington isn't a guy that, like, usually presents you with a ton of fantasy upside. Like, when he puts up big games, it's because he knocks down, like, 4 or 5 threes. He gets, like, 8 or 10 rebounds. I mean, he could definitely do that here in a fast-paced game against the Bucks. They're going to need his defense against Giannis, so definitely have interest in Robert Covington at 5,700 as well. For value, though, Terrence Ross, you can play here, who I don't mind going to. I definitely think you get some value from Minnesota at small four. You got Bates Diop at 4,100, Keelan Martin at 4K. We saw Keelan Martin start in place of Travion Graham last game. It'll be interesting to see if Travion Graham plays today. And if he does play, do they decide to move him back into the starting lineup? With just Martin starting last game, against Brooklyn, he played 35 minutes as a starter, 22 DraftKings points. Wasn't very productive on a point-per-minute basis, but the minutes were definitely there. Bates Diop got a lot of run off the bench, 27 minutes off the bench, had 33 DraftKings points. He was much more productive. I think both these guys are in play today, especially if Martin continues to start at 4K. I have interest in him. Bates Diop, I think, is going to get a lot of run off the bench and 4,100. Both those guys are definitely in play as small forward values. Josh Okogie you could consider as well. But now moving on to power forward, Anthony Davis, I do like quite a bit today against the Suns. I think it's going to be pretty easy to like get Davis and Giannis into the same lineup if you want to go that route. There should be enough value to do so, especially with all the value that Minnesota is presenting us with. So Davis I like a lot at 9,900. I think he is a little bit too cheap on DraftKings. I think this is a matchup against the Suns. He can easily win. He can easily have success here. I do prefer him over LeBron. I still think Giannis is my top stud today, but Anthony Davis is number two, with LeBron being a close third. So I like paying up for AD. Love Julius Randle, but he's up to 8K on DraftKings. So at 8K on DK, you can probably look elsewhere. I don't think you have to go to him at that salary. If I'm going to play him anywhere, it's definitely going to be on Yahoo, where he's only $33. I think he's still way underpriced over there. If you wanted to take out Melo and replace him with Randle, I'm totally fine doing that. I do like Randle quite a bit at 33. He's been balling lately, been playing big minutes. The Knicks have been able to keep games close recently, and we're seeing Randle play 37, 35, 38 minutes, 50, 43, 56 fantasy points. Like, he's just been crushing lately, and now he gets another good matchup against Portland, who has really struggled against power forwards this season. Jonathan Isaac, though, I talked about, really like him. Oubre, I have some interest in. But if he's going to be like, if he's going to come in really popular today, I think that's a play you can definitely fade in tournaments, just with him being like a streaky shooter. With him being hot the last few games, people are going to chase that. So in tournaments, I like pivoting to guys like Anthony, Isaac, Covington as well. Really no value at power forward, though, besides the Minnesota guys. Bates Diop, you can play here. Naz Reid, I think, is definitely interesting. He got 20 minutes off the bench last game against Brooklyn. Had 24 DraftKings points. He was very productive on a points-per-minute basis. I'm not sure how many minutes he plays today. I imagine he'll get some run at power forward. He'll get some run at center. 3,900, if he's going to get like 24 minutes, 22, 24 minutes at this salary, you can definitely target him as a value today. He will for sure be in my player pool as a cheap option. But yeah, let's go ahead and move over to center now. We'll talk about center just before we end the video. So looking at center today, you got AD here. You got Whiteside at 8,300. Price finally came up on DraftKings. He was 7,100 on the last slate. He was incredibly chalky. You kind of had to play him, and I mean, he put up a really good game for his salary. Had 54 DK points in 37 minutes against the Suns. Like, Whiteside is just playing huge minutes right now. 37 minutes last game. Like, he's playing 34, 36 minutes in close games as of late. He only got 25 minutes earlier this season against the Knicks, but that game was a blowout. He still put up 49 DraftKings points in only 25 minutes. Like, Whiteside is just such a point-per-minute beast. He's still one of my favorite centers to pay up for. On DraftKings, I would prefer him over Vucevic. I would prefer him over Randle. On Yahoo, you have Whiteside at $39 at center, whereas you have, like, Jang for $25. I think on Yahoo, with it being the three-game slate with no Vucevic on this slate, I still think Whiteside's one of the top options. Factoring in salary, though, I probably would prefer to drop down to Jang for $14 cheaper, but I still expect to have a lot of Whiteside on Yahoo, especially because Vucevic is not available on the main slate, so you can't really pivot to him. You could pivot him on DraftKings. I imagine he's going to come in lower owned than Whiteside. Vuce is definitely in a smash spot here against the Wizards. He put up 63 DraftKings points earlier this season against the Wizards. We know how bad this team is defensively versus bigs, how much they are struggling to defend bigs right now. No Thomas Bryant, no Mo Wagner, no Rui Hachimura. This is easily a team you can defeat down low. I mean, we know how good of a matchup this is. Wizards are third in pace this season. They are dead last in defensive rating, dead last in rebound percentage. They're a terrible rebounding team. Vooch should be able to kill them on the glass. So I do like him a ton. It's really close between like Whiteside, Vooch, and Randle. I think all three of those guys are really good plays today. Since Randle's price is way up on DraftKings, I would probably consider him the third guy. So I'd rank them Whiteside 1, Vucevic 2, Randle 3. But all guys would definitely be in my player pool, especially if I was playing multiple lineups. And you can roster Randle at power forward, which definitely makes him appealing. But then you have like DeAndre Ayton at 6,700, who is way too cheap today. We're going to have to watch like news here. He didn't start last game. He came off the bench against Portland. Only played 20 minutes. They said they were going to limit his minutes. He put up a fantasy point per minute. He had 20 DraftKings points in 20 minutes. If we get DeAndre Ayton back in the starting lineup with no minutes restriction, he is definitely one of my favorite plays at 6,700. But that'll just be news we have to wait and see on. He's coming back from an ankle injury, so there's a chance they limit him more than just one game. Like, he could be limited a few more games. We'll just have to wait and see there. So with the uncertainty with Ayton's status, like with his limits or whatever, I'm fine going to Gorgui Dieng as of now. 6,400 on DK, and on Yahoo, he's at $25. I mean, so Gorgui Dieng's just been absolutely balling recently. He's been starting in place of Karl-Anthony Towns, who's been out for like the last like six or seven games, and he's been playing big minutes. We've seen Dieng get 36 minutes, 30 minutes, 41 minutes in an overtime game, 33 minutes last game against Brooklyn. I mean, I think he plays probably 32 to 34 minutes today. He's been a point-per-minute beast this season when given minutes. If we look at his rates this season, didn't mean to click on the Bucks. We can look at his rates with the Timberwolves. Probably don't even need to take anybody off the floor because I don't know if that's really going to affect Dieng. Like, I mean, he's not going to play alongside Towns, so we don't really need to take Towns off the floor. But just this season with everybody on the floor, Gorgui Dieng's played 464 minutes, averaging 1.16 fantasy points per minute, which is pretty solid for a guy at 6,400. Just with those rates, giving him like 1.15 to 1.2 fantasy points per minute, playing 34 minutes, like he probably projects for about 40 DraftKings points, if not more. It's a fast-paced game against the Bucks. There's going to be a lot of opportunity for rebounds in this game, for just shots to go up. It's going to be a fast-paced game. Dieng played 17 minutes off the bench against Milwaukee the last time they played. He was really productive, putting up 25 DraftKings points in 17 minutes. Like, this is a guy that has legit upside. I mean, we've seen him go for 48 DraftKings points multiple times in his last three games, twice in his last three games. It was a great matchup against Brooklyn last game. He had a big game, 11 points, 20 rebounds, 2 assists, one block and 3 steals. Like, I love Gorgui Dieng today. I hope with the price coming up, people are going to shy away from him. I think the minutes are going to be there. As long as he can stay out of foul trouble, he's going to play 30 to 32 minutes. I think if there was a game like, or if there was a matchup where I would be concerned with foul trouble, this would definitely be it. Like with Giannis driving to the basket, like there's definitely a chance Dieng picks up some foul trouble here. But I mean, I can't predict blowouts. I can't predict foul trouble. So if Dieng gets his full minutes, like he can definitely crush this $6,400 salary. I'm hoping people shy away from him with the price coming up. I still love him on today's slate. But that's probably it for me for center. Like, Ian Mahimi had a monster game last game. He played 28 minutes against the Heat, had 41 DraftKings points. Like, Mahimi's going to get probably 26 to 28 minutes. Against the Magic, you could definitely consider him. It's not a good matchup, but he'd be in play for me at least. He's been productive this season when given the minutes as well. I feel like center, though, is probably going to be a position I either go to the mid-range, like with Dieng or Ayton. If I'm not going to those two guys, I'm going to be looking to pay up for like Davis, Whiteside, Vooch, or Randle. So don't see myself going cheap here, but I guess Mahimi would be an option. Aaron Baines did start last game, even with Ayton healthy. It'll be interesting to see if Ayton is limited. Like, if Ayton's limited again and Baines continues to start, you can definitely consider him as a value play. 4,700 on DK. He got 27 minutes, even with Ayton healthy. He had 29 DraftKings points in 27 minutes. He's a fine value, especially if he starts and Ayton remains limited. I could definitely consider him a value play. But that's really it for me for center plays today. I think we covered everything, guys. So I think we pretty much broke down this four-game slate for DK, three-gamer for Yahoo. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. Hopefully it did help you. If you enjoyed, before you get out of here, I would appreciate it if you would drop a like down below. Subscribe to the channel if you have not yet, and click that notification bell so that way you get notified every time I upload. If you haven't yet, you can follow me on Twitter as well. My Twitter is at DFSByNoah. Feel free to give me a follow over there. Link is down in the description. Also down in the description is my Patreon if you want to check out all the exclusive content I have to offer over there. I post NBA content Monday through Friday. Have NFL stuff going up throughout the week as well. I will have NFL content for the wild card slate coming up probably Thursday or Friday is when I'll post that. I'll also have a video up on my YouTube channel for the wild card slate. Either might get it up Wednesday morning. If it's not up Wednesday, it'll definitely be up by Thursday for the wild card slate. But good luck tonight, guys. Hope you guys had a happy new year. Enjoy your day. Hopefully, if you got a day off of work, enjoy the day off of work. But good luck tonight, guys. Thanks for watching. Have a good day. Peace.